Hey you, it's me, MK, welcoming you to my little corner in the Shadow Realm, and this is a message dedicated to all the Flash games I played as a kid. Ah yes, some of my favorite childhood memories involve me spending many an afternoon playing games mostly consisting of my favorite properties on my dad's computer. It's one of the memories most of us 2000s kids share, and I think it's safe to say it was our earliest exposure to the world of video games. And no matter if the voice acting is tacky,
what a nightmare,
or the controls may turn out to be a lot clunkier than our brains tell us, we still hold them dear in our memories. But when we fast forward to the present, it has been months since Adobe Flash Player went defunct, and now all classic Flash games that haven't made a successful transition to another format are no longer accessible on any browser. That's at least 20 years of content down the drain. Thankfully, we've got the program known as Flashpoint to salvage most, if not all, of our favorite games. But even though they're preserved there, this is very much the end of an era, and I'd like to voice my appreciation for all of the games I grew up with. Especially since the realization of there being only 1 month left before the plug got pulled hit me hard and led me down a rabbit hole that upon revisitation allowed me to finally put together why these humble little games are so great. Keep in mind that during this retrospective, I'm only gonna talk about the ones most personal to me, so if they're not in here, I either had minimal attachment to them, there aren't enough on Flashpoint to get adequate video footage for a section, or I simply don't have that much to say except they were fun while they lasted. As stated earlier, not all of these games have been uploaded to Flashpoint yet, so I'll be providing pictures for the few games I was unable to record footage of. This script has also been a work in progress since December, so we have a lot of games to go through. Anyway, join me on this surprisingly affectionate deep dive as we take a trip down memory lane. When you think about Barbie, what's the first thing that comes to mind? The dolls? The movies? Life in the Dreamhouse and the comedy genius that is none other than Raquel?
Poison Ivy!
Raquel, they're daisies!
Poison daisies!
Well, the website is my first thought. Barbie has come a long way since the 1950s, and the website is all the proof we need. As expected, there's a lot of dress-up games, but they're not the only things to choose from, which is good because I can't say that much about dress-up games without being repetitive. One of the most iconic games is Let's Babysit Baby Chrissy. What you do is self-explanatory. You babysit Baby Chrissy. It's simple and chill, but still fun. You're given three tasks to do, randomized every time. They range from feeding Chrissy breakfast and bathing her, to taking her grocery shopping and watching her play on the playground with a friend. Really, the charm comes from the sound effects and Chrissy being an adorable little baby. I still crack up whenever I put Chrissy and her friend on the swings for a long period of time. The way the food moves and jumps in Chrissy's shopping cart is also pretty cute. Especially those little gingerbread cookies. You know, this art style was used in another game I love just as much as Baby Chrissy, Zoom and Groom. I mean, you can dress up dogs, cats, and horses in cute outfits? Sign me up! My favorite look was the cowgirl attire for the Golden Retrievers. Truly classic. We also have a great callback to the Baby Chrissy game because you can see her and her friend on the swings when you groom the dogs and on the map when Barbie is driving to the cat photoshoot. My only complaint is that when you add the stick-on stickers, you can't remove them. That would have been a nice option. Another game I really like is Give Ken a Hot New Look. It's pretty unique considering it's one of the only dress-up games I grew up with where you could dress up a boy. But that's not all. You can also give him a car, a song to jam out to, a career, and a personality trait. Kudos to Mattel for letting you do more here. Surfer Ken was my favorite as a kid, but now I'm more into the rocker style. Actually, that's a perfect segue into the next game, Cali Girl Beach Blast. This is pretty much a personality quiz disguised as a dress-up game, and you get to pick your end result. How cool is that? Really, that's the charm of all these Barbie games. They're simple, but still fun. Cali Girl Horse Adventure is also nice. You can decorate your own horse. Unless you can't. But the horses look really pretty regardless. You can even speedrun this if you're looking for a challenge. Watch and learn. And of course, we can't go a second further without talking about the movie tie-in games. Each one had its own. Princess and the Pauper was more of a fill-in-the-blank deal, Mermaidia let you design the background of the underwater cave as well as Alina's mermaid tail, Mariposas was kind of like Princess and the Pauper but with mini-games between pages, Diamond Castle Rocks is oddly satisfying, Magic of the Rainbow is only memorable because they let you make your own avatar out of Alina, Glee, Sunburst, and Lumina's clothes and hair, and who could forget the Magic of Pegasus 3D game? I would play that one over and over again for the flying sequences alone, which apparently you can skip, but I don't see why anybody would want to miss out on the best part of the game. It's only topped by the 12 Dancing Princesses, which would add a princess each day until the movie's release to learn more about them in the film. Each princess has information about their personalities, favorite gemstones, and favorite flowers, along with a little extra goodie. We have posters, storybooks, clips, images, a personality quiz that hits differently now that Steven Universe exists, and behind-the-scenes info on the ballerina motion capture. Genevieve, of course, gets the best goodie, her very own dancing game, and Lacey's arrival makes up for giving no info about her at all by taking us to the Enchanted Ballroom to watch every princess dance, not just Genevieve. I also gotta give props to the naming system. You could put in your boring old name, or you could get a super cool and fun princess name. By the time I stopped playing on the Barbie website, the last games I really enjoyed were the career-oriented ones. I played the ballerina, doctor, and dentist ones a lot, and in hindsight, it's pleasantly surprising that the Barbie dentist game wasn't gross like the Girls Go Games garbage that started spawning near the same time. Be thankful I'm sparing your eyes from having to look at something that assaults all of your senses, by the way. But my favorite out of all of these was and still is the snowboarding one, Halfpipe Pixie. What can I say? I love high-speed action-packed games, especially when there's so many combos I can try out. Now, I have to ask, did you people out there have computer lab time back in elementary school? I sure did. Our teachers had us go to all kinds of websites like Spelling City, Discovery Channel, and even Webkinz every now and then because the teacher decided we were well-behaved enough. For those of you who said yes, you were probably raised on Cool Math. But in my class, we were hardcore Fun Brain kids. Trying to revisit the classic Fun Brain arcades through the Wayback Machine was a hard thing to do because the link stopped working after the Fruit Loops game for regular arcade and Inkster for math arcade, so Flashpoint was a huge help in seeing what else I never played. Penguin Drop and Mighty Guy are by far top tier games. It's surprisingly fun to spam the spacebar and shoot down all of the falling penguins. And Mighty Guy's aesthetic is on point. It's perfect for a website that constantly advertised the Diary of a Wimpy Kid series. It's no surprise this one got a sequel, which amps up the difficulty but not to the point where it's unplayable. Admittedly, for the math arcade, I usually didn't get past the pig toss game. I remember it being that hard. Even if I got lucky, I'd only make it to the next two games before the computer lab session ended. But when revisiting it? Wow, it was way easier than I remembered. I got past it without a single game over, although I did get lucky on a last try. But then I faced a new challenge, the Inkster game. Drop the number in the pile, but don't run into other sea creatures. Easy enough, right? Look, normally I like fast-paced action, but our little squid buddy flies too out of control and keeps running into the numbers I don't want. It took me 10 minutes to get past this game. After that, I tried a bunch of other games, even going through some that weren't part of either arcade, and I can say for sure that Fun Brain as a whole is overall solid. Well, except the bug ones. I hate bugs, so them really making use of the buzzing and realistic-looking designs are just gross. Yet I digress. As far as educational games go, Fun Brain is where it's at. Too bad they never finished the arcade boards, though. What a letdown. But enough about Fun Brain. Let's tackle something fun without the extra educational value. That's right, I'm talking about Cartoon Network. Admittedly, I didn't grow up much on their shows. I was only allowed to watch half of them until I turned 13, so most of my exposure to the forbidden territory happened to be only because of the website. I can't remember a lot specifically, but the ones I always went back to were Tom and Jerry, Powerpuff Girls, Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends, Hi Hi Puffy AmiYumi, and Crypto the Superdog. The only show on this list I never actually watched was Crypto the Superdog, so the one game, Heroes Unite, is the only nostalgia I have of it. This is a 3-in-1. School Run has Crypto keeping Kevin out of harm's way as he makes it to school at the last minute, Asteroid sees Crypto helping Streaky after he's caught in a field of asteroids, and Kryptonite Attack has Ace the Bat Hound destroying Kryptonite crystals to save Crypto. Kryptonite attack is the one I'd play the most due to the never-ending fire Ace can send out to the almost never-ending kryptonite shards flying his way. It's very cathartic. As far as Hi Hi Puffy AmiYumi goes, I remember playing Treasure Island crazy often, but I never actually finished it because of how difficult it is. A kid could easily get lost trying to traverse the map.
I'm back in the fucking building again!
Not to mention a naughty old friend of mine kept dying at the hands of the lion because he wouldn't stop waking him up. My Flashpoint playthrough is by far my best run, but that's not really saying much because I only found the slingshot and banana before dying, and I never even learned how to use the banana. But in spite of it, is it a good game? Yes. Do I have problems with it? Also yes. The idea of the stealthy run and gun is neat, and I love how smoothly Ami and Yumi run, but they move way too quickly. If they stuck with run and gun while removing the stealth elements or making some of the areas less crowded, it could have been less unbeatable than it already is. World Tour is much more functional, and it's totally awesome! It's a fun little platformer where Ami and Yumi jump over cars and avoid adoring fans in order to get to their concert. You control whichever girl leads the way, and when she gets tired, the other has to step in or else it's game over. Planet Tokyo playing in the background makes it even more exciting because of how much of a bop it is. The two Powerpuff Girls games I played most often were PPG vs. Towns Villains and Pillow Fight. The first one is pretty simple. Fuzzy Lumpkins, him, and Roach Coach cause trouble and you need to stop them. You play as all three girls and fly to the rescue. The first portion has you fly through Townsville and click on all projectiles sent your way, whether they be giant food, fireballs, or bugs. The second portion has you clicking on not only the projectile, but also the enemy you're meant to defeat. This culminates in all three of them escaping from jail to serve as a final boss-boss rush combo. The sound effects can get a bit grating after a while, but the theme song playing in the background makes it all super hype. It's also a good reflex tester because you never know when the air portion is suddenly gonna stop and shove you into boss battle mode. The pillow fight game is much more polished. Here, all three girls are having a big pillow fight. Each one has their advantage. Blossom throws the fastest, Bubbles runs the fastest, and Buttercup recovers the fastest. Blossom's my overall favorite of the PPG, but I have better luck at winning whenever I use Bubbles. Now, honestly, I'm cheating a little here with the Foster's Home games because they're not as nostalgic as the others on this list. I only played Big Shot Checkers as a kid, and the rest of them I didn't discover until I was 13. Those were 8 to 9 years ago, though, so I say they count! Big Shot Checkers is a rather interesting case. You see, when Race for Your Life Mac and Blue was made, they had two endings, one for Mac winning the race, and one for Blue winning the race. So whenever you played, the character you picked determined who you voted for. I was Team Blue and still am to this very day! Even though the canon Mac ending to the episode is slightly better. In case you guys never knew they made the alternate Blue ending, that version of the episode is available on iTunes and probably on other less trustworthy websites if you want to check it out. But without the novelty of voting, this is a fun game of checkers. In addition to the basics, Mac and Blue ride on the game pieces and whichever one they're on is called the Big Shot. This provides an extra mode of winning. If you get the Big Shot piece all the way to the other side of the board, it's an automatic win. It also provides an extra move option, where you can move your character to another piece instead of moving one of your pieces across the board. Also, these animations are super cute. But yeah, it's cool that they added a nice twist to what would otherwise be just a normal game of checkers. Aside from this one, no Foster's game beats Mid-Flight Snack. In this one, Mac, Blue, and Eduardo use a seesaw to grab all kinds of food and sweet treats. Their excitement whenever they jump is super contagious! Especially Blue, but I'm a bit biased here since he's always been my favorite.
Look out, Air Blue coming through!
Yummy!
Yes!
Ooh, the star! Get the star!
Woo!
Yeah, baby!
What I really like here is how every time you get food or a star, you increase your time, so the game can last for a long while if you're really good. I can personally testify because I've gotten the highest ranking, Bellyache, in every playthrough except one. Though really, the Tom and Jerry one slapped the hardest. I played all of these before Colossal Catastrophe was added to the site. Out of the big three, my go-to game is usually What's the Catch. You can play as Tom or Jerry. Both provide different scenarios with you either chasing down Jerry or escaping from Tom. In Jerry's game, it's a fast-paced, action-packed chase where Jerry must jump over toys and collect floating cheese. In the medium and hard difficulties, some obstacles are big enough to require a double jump, and there's also a slight chance Tom will try to grab Jerry.
Yes, this low-key feels unfair when he strikes at the worst possible moment, but hey, at least it keeps you on your fingers. Besides, it's nowhere near as hard as Tom's game, where you have two phases, catching plates and catching glasses. This is a game of concentration where you should never let your guard down if you want to win. Assume that every glass that falls will break if you don't click on them. But once Jerry's captured, you can relax. That's my favorite thing about What's the Catch. It's so satisfying to play as my favorite cat boy and defeat the tiny rodent menace. Speaking of, Tom's Trap-O-Matic requires a lot of brain power. You gotta make your own crazy contraption that goes all around the kitchen or the living room without waking up Spike or leaving Jerry unscathed. The sense of victory isn't quite as strong here compared to What's the Catch, but it's still funny. And the music bangs. Not to mention how you can get really creative here. I mean, look at all of these little things you can use to catch Jerry. Moving on, Refrigerators is very much a sequel to What's the Catch, if not spiritual successor. It expands on both games, giving you more to do and making the obstacles way harder. So, in Jerry's game, he has to drop food from the fridge and into Nibbles' mouth. The problem? Nibbles keeps running across the screen, and Tom tries to knock you down with billiard balls. On hard mode, he will near automatically put the ball on the shelf you're already on, so stay away from the edges when the ball on screen is almost done rolling away. And if you want to get a perfect score, you have to drop the cheese from the highest shelf and at the right time so you don't get hit or let it crash onto the floor. Cherries don't spawn as often, but they give you extra points, so be sure to use them as much as you can. Out of curiosity, I experimented to see if I could do an all cherry run. I can't. Also, kudos to the winning screen for being a reference to the Little Orphan. I've been a full-on Tom and Jerry fan since 2012, so I like catching subtle references like this. Tom's game is much more difficult, and thankfully the developers acknowledge this because they give you some mercy through two extra lives. Here, you throw water balloons at Jerry and Nibbles as they run across a laundry line with the food they stole from the fridge. In order to get a perfect score, you have to hit the mice every single time because extra points are rewarded for a combo streak. This is hard to do when you reach hard mode because Tom's aim is gone, so you need to memorize that spot on the screen and the speed of the mice to know when to strike and make it to victory. And boy oh boy is that victory satisfying! Tom and I made a fool of Jerry in front of Nibbles and he is pissed! Really lets that glory sink in, you know? It at least softens the blow to how nightmarish it may be to completionists. And that brings us to Run Jerry Run, which I appreciate for the stage's spooky environments alone. They're loosely based on Tom and Jerry Tales episodes, which by the way is a really good Tom and Jerry reboot, and it shows, like the first level being a nod to Over the River and Boo the Woods, the second to Spookhouse Mouse, and the third... Well, I never actually watched any medieval-themed episodes, but I know for sure that a batch of them exists, so it's gotta be a nod to one of those. Even if you didn't know this, the trees with scary faces look like they came straight out of Snow White, and the funhouse gives off Coraline vibes. Quick warning, this game's angled where Jerry is running towards the camera, so it's harder to predict when the obstacles are coming unless you have a really good memory during replays. And you better have good depth perception like I do when the pits appear, or else they'll be your downfall. Literally. Finally, we have Food Free For All, also known as Food Fight. This is a Q-Bert type of game where Jerry has to collect all the cheese in the stage while avoiding Tom, the evil kitten triplets Muff, Fluff, and Puff, and getting his ass burned off. Unlike Q-Bert, though, the stage is entirely flat, so it makes it easier to navigate, but you can still lose lives by hopping off the platforms because no invisible walls exist to protect you from that penalty. There's other food that gives you bonus points like sausages, but you don't need to pick them up to complete the level. Hard mode is harder than I remember, but I like a good challenge. Well done! So, with all this gushing about the Cartoon Network games, you're probably wondering, did I ever get bored? Where would I go when I wasn't playing there? Well, worry not, dear friends, I wasn't picky. When I wanted more, I just defaulted to Disney Channel. Their shows rocked, and so did their games. It's just pure fun all around. I've noticed that one of the most fondly looked back shows of the network is The Sweet Life of Zack and Cody. And I can absolutely see why. The comedy and characters still hold up, not to mention the theme song gives me chills. It only makes sense that they're the first games I cover.
Kitchen Commotion of Zack and Cody is the one I remember playing the most. It's a fighting game where Zack, Cody, London, and Maddie all fight each other in the kitchen. The bigger the pastry, the more points you get when you land a hit on your opponent, but be careful when Mr. Mosby checks on you or else you'll lose points instead. At the end of every round, you can collect cookies for an extra score boost, and whoever loses the food fight has to do most of the cleaning. I love how smoothly the controls work, making it easy to collect more ammo while your fighter is still vulnerable enough to get hit at least once beforehand. And the speed is great too, quick enough to avoid feeling sluggish, but not overly slippery like Hi Hi Puffy AmiYumi's Treasure Island. The spike in difficulty with each level is noticeable enough, but it's easy to avoid losing your lead by focusing on collecting fast rather than banking on the huge cakes. Next, we have Zack and Cody's Camera Twin Spin. Zack, Cody, London, and Maddie want to be famous in Hollywood, so they work behind the scenes. Zack and Cody control the cameras and collect red and yellow stars, costumes, awards, and all the letters that spell Hollywood while avoiding boom mics and spotlights. The level design intrigues me. Technically, there's only one level and it only ends when your meter runs out, but the scenery changes whenever you spell Hollywood. You're brought into a fast-paced bonus round, and by the end of it, you've gone from the Wild West to Mars, Mars to the Wizarding World, and the Wizarding World to the Wild West again. It can come off as repetitive when you notice this, but as long as you focus on getting the point combos, you'll probably be fine. I will say though, the intense orange Mars area doesn't look good against the red and yellow stars. That's just bad color clashing. You know what game looks better overall? Spike Ball. Zack and Cody want to play volleyball, but there's just one teeny tiny problem. They live in a hotel and it's the middle of winter, complete with snow. So Arwen helps them invent a new game with his inventions, and Spike Ball was born. Think volleyball mixed with that one catch game where you have a huge curved stick to get the ball and with five different balls to play with. Right off the bat, I have to give props to the opponent section. Look at how many people there are! Of course, you have Zack, Cody, London, and Maddie, but you can also play against Carrie, Arwen, and Mosby. You know Mosby was an opportunity I couldn't pass up. The controls are a bit weird here, but not the worst. You have to collect all the points and spikes by pointing your cursor to aim, but the smaller the ball, the harder it can be to catch. And even worse is when you aim right at the edge and end up getting a net bubble instead. But minor frustrations aside, I like it. The solid gameplay and the opponent roster make it worth playing at least once. Finally, I'm proud to say that Zack and Cody have the most unique game across the entire Disney Channel website, Medieval Quest. Based on that World of Warcraft game that Zack and Mosby become addicted to, Carrie, London, Maddie, and Cody give it a try, but their characters end up trapped in the dungeons. Mosby is busy with his own quest, so Zack has to step in and be their hero. If you looked at a couple seconds of gameplay footage alone, you wouldn't even guess that this is a Zack and Cody game. The whole area looks perfect for a Rotting Castle dungeon, complete with health items and treasure chests all over the place. As you help Zack save his mom, friend, crush, and brother, Mosby will pop in to explain some things to you, such as not to drink what's obviously poison and stay away from the crystal balls since they drain your magic. Once you set a character free, you'll find yourself running into more enemies that are harder and harder to destroy, and the game does the perfect job at introducing them. Each new enemy type is first seen right outside of the cell holding a character hostage. After you beat them and free whoever you're going after, the next level uses them regularly, which makes the spike in difficulty worthy of being called one, and it keeps you on your toes, ready to prepare for when the next type strikes. Interestingly, Cody's the only one who avoids this rule, as the enemy types introduced when rescuing Maddie are the same ones guarding his cell, which makes sense since that's the last level. The only downside I can see to this game is that it's easy to get lost either trying to find the key or looking for the cell. Sometimes it puts you in a tough spot when you encounter enemies, but the rooms tend to have healing items like fruit, cookies, and an overpowered health potion, so it at least serves as a last resort before you continue getting lost in the maze. And Zack's friends and family keep nagging you for not finding them yet. But can I just say, I love their avatars? Carrie's looks so elegant, like Rosalina, and it's cool to see what her blonde hair looks like long. London is of course a princess because she's the show's queen. Maddie is a badass archer girl because why wouldn't she be a tough go-getter? And Cody looks way different from his normal self. I know we're just getting started, but this is probably my favorite Disney Channel game, period. Okay, so Suite Life of Zack and Cody may have been the pinnacle of Disney Channel shows, but Wizards of Waverly Place is close behind. And considering Medieval Quest was the last game we went through, this is the perfect segue. Runaway Runaway is my favorite. Alex accidentally turns her laundry into stars in the sky, and Justin and Max have to help her get them back. Out of all the games in the Disney Channel lineup, this one somehow relaxes me. Maybe because it's a bit lower energy, only requiring mouse movements and clicks to play as Justin and Max collect stars in their little shape patterns. Just make sure you don't drop them. They'll be fine thanks to the magic carpet, but lose both and you can't really play. Even the music is on the chiller side, so I get the feeling it's on purpose. Play this for a good time, and especially if you're in need of unwinding. Conversely, you also have Magic Curse Reverse, which is loosely based on that one episode where Alex wants her uncle to be her teacher, and they turn into sea monkeys after getting too carried away. The spell is the same, but this time Alex has to clean up the school for an upcoming dance. Max thought it was a spell to instantly clean so they could get their hands on some ice cream nachos in less than 10 minutes. But he picked the wrong one because, of course, he's Max, and the three siblings have to get their spellbook to undo their flooded mess before it's too late. Magic Curse Reverse is weird. It looks weird, it plays weird, and sometimes it's frustrating. As each sibling swims to reach the book, you have to avoid floating furniture and zap monsters to turn them back into regular items while collecting points from food, shoes, and action figures. Sometimes the spaces are tight, and the zappings won't register unless your position is just right. Compared to the other games I'm listing, I wouldn't recommend this one. The other game I played often was made in preparation for the movie, and it's actually split into two: Journey to the Cave of Darkness and Quest for the Stone of Dreams. They play very similarly, with the biggest difference being that Quest has voice acting.
Get the knife, show the light.
It's a fast-paced, action-packed platformer with some spell casting. Perfect for a game based on a show about wizards. One thing I notice is that the levitation spell seems required to cast at times, so I appreciate that extra step rather than it being a safeguard for newbies. The games also hide a lot of the movie's plot, so they avoid being spoilery while also making sure Max has the time of his life back at the beach. I can't even pick which one is better because they're so intertwined, like both halves of Kill Bill. Truly, a job well done for a game split in two. But really, if any Disney Channel show was an absolute icon in pop culture, it was Kim Possible. Who knew a kid's show about a world-saving spy in high school who also ends up having one of the best friends-to-lovers romance of all time would make history? Surely her games would match these high expectations, right? Well, let's just say I found quite the amount of misses among the hits. Shopping Avenger and Ron's Free Fall run into similar problems: horrible pacing. In Shopping Avenger, Kim needs to get the right outfit and gear at Club Banana before heading off to defeat Draken and Shigo, but the running is high puffy AmiYumi fast and the jumping is slippery. Not to mention, when you get the right piece, it isn't locked in, so it's easy to lose in such a short amount of time. At least when you lose, you get some sick burns from Shigo and Draken, so that's gotta make up for something, right?
You both obviously know why I'm here.
Obviously. You've accepted the job as my table lamp!
As for Ron's freefall, Ron has to collect the scattered pages of his homework while on a mission. You have to make sure the teeny tiny net he holds touches the pages to catch them, and I genuinely don't remember there being this many tight spaces. Both of these were great ideas and had a good start, but unfortunately this one little issue makes or breaks them. Supervillain Face-Off is a bite-sized puzzle bobble clone with no lives, so it's nowhere near as good as Webkinz' Zynga's Pop, but it's still okay, I guess. Now for the good stuff, because I don't like being negative unless I need to be. Card Clash is a war clone, but despite its simplicity, it's actually quite fun. You can battle your cards against Draken or Shigo and pick from the hero or villain skins. The aesthetic is on point, and there's nothing else I could ask for. Supervillain Smash Out is a similar deal, being a Pong clone this time, but it's hard to mess up Pong. There's even power-ups and power-downs, though I'm surprised Bonnie's on the good guy side. She's a bully, so it would have made more sense to put her on the bad guy side and balance out both teams. But regardless, I know I can have a great time here. Following this trend is Rufus Recall, which is a memory game with powers. I'm not one for memory games because they're all pretty much the same, but this one stands out with power-ups, including one that actually shows all the hidden cards for a couple seconds. So I have to give credit where it's due. It's not bad at all. But you know which Kim Possible game is the best? Bueno Rufus. Our favorite naked mole rat is working at Bueno Nacho and helping finish orders. Sodas for cups, cheese for nachos, sauce for tacos, and hot fudge for ice cream. I'm convinced there's no end to this game, and I love it. It has everything I could hope for in a Rufus-themed Kim Possible game. Action, quick reflex requirements, and a food-based environment.
It gets harder and faster as it goes, so this is perfect. I could play for hours. Okay, I guess since we're in the animation portion of the Disney Channel games, no, not that one, I shouldn't avoid Phineas and Ferb anymore. It's probably the most popular and beloved show from last decade, and I understand because I loved it too. I'm just a bit bitter towards it now because it robbed Milo Murphy's Law of its identity and destroyed it. Regardless, the games remind me of better days when the show wasn't screwing other shows over. I've probably played every game at least once, but the only ones I know I for sure came back to were Snow Problem and Cowabunga Candace. Snow Problem is one of those trampoline bouncing games. Loosely based on Swinter, Phineas and Ferb are making snow in their backyard and bounce the snowballs to the other side of the backyard to make a large snow mountain. But Doofenshmirtz is flying his blimp nearby, so Perry has to stop him from melting the snow. Basically, in addition to jumping snow at a pace that feels sluggish by level 7, you have to click your mouse before Doofenshmirtz gets too close. Oh, and if you get hit by the giant ice cubes, you'll be out of commission for a few seconds, which doesn't feel like a lot, but can cause you to lose many point opportunities. Where this game really shines is when Candace comes sliding in. When she hits the snow machine, a whole fleet of snowballs are unleashed onto the field, and it's so satisfying! I love bouncing them all! Almost as satisfying are the bonus rounds, where it's an extreme close-up and the snowballs keep falling faster and faster. I've never gotten a 100% score on those, but I've come really close, so at least it's something. Thanks to Phineas and Ferb's running speed being rather slow, this is similar to Runaway Runway in that it's a good game to relax to. However, Cowabunga Candace is the best Phineas and Ferb game by a mile. It's great when your body's low energy, but your mind's racing a mile a minute. Phineas and Ferb are having a surfing contest in their own backyard, and Candace enters to impress Jeremy. You control her as she surfs down a never-ending wave and collects little confidence pellets to perform tricks while avoiding obstacles. Candace can also collect bonus tricks that can be used anytime thanks to the spacebar. If Jeremy sees her doing one, she gets bonus points. There's also a collectible bonus round that if you're really good can last for many levels. That's the weird thing about this game though, the levels don't end. They just say you made it to the next one as a warning that things are gonna get harder soon. I played Cowabunga Candace for around half an hour before I finally lost all my lives, and I'm proud to say that after at least a decade, I finally got that gold trophy! It feels great! You know what else feels great? Revisiting the one Sunny with a Chance game I'd play over and over. Well, at least the one I could actually find. The scavenger hunt game I can't find on Flashpoint or YouTube, so I have to settle with only covering Studio 3 Snap Cartapult. But hey, this is my favorite one, so I can't complain. So Random wants to get even in their never-ending feud against Mackenzie Falls, so Sunny and her co-stars take prop food to drop onto Chad and his co-stars during filming. There's three rounds separated in three parts. Food bouncing, food dropping, and food dodging. Food bouncing starts off with just Sunny and Tawny bouncing food off of a trampoline into their cart, but soon includes Grady and Nico as well as Zora to control. Then the food dropping is self-explanatory, but with each round it gets harder when Chad and Penelope want revenge. That's where the final phase comes in. Food dodging. You have to make sure that Sunny and the gang jump and duck at the right time to avoid getting hit, or else you'll lose points. Weirdly, even if you dodge flawlessly, you'll still be treated to everybody being covered in frosting. Oh well, it's still a great game. And now for the first and only movie-related section, let's cover Camp Rock. It's no High School Musical, and of course we're now old enough to realize that shoulder roll tested was totally lame. But we got two great games from here, Rockin' Run and Guitar Groovin' 101. Rockin' Run is a strange combo of Pac-Man and a condensed collect-a-thon where the Jams' instruments are missing so you have to collect them without getting caught. This makes it off-putting when you realize the Jonas Brothers are trying to stop you from making sure the jam goes swimmingly. They're campers, shouldn't they be helping you? Alongside that little bit of weirdness, the spike in difficulty makes the Jonas AIs near impossible to get past. Seriously, they won't stop guarding the stage! Sometimes the game is unbeatable at worst, but the journey is more important than the destination, so for the most part, it's fine as long as you can hit the right triggers to get the Joe Bros to chase you and leave the stage open. The other game, Guitar Groovin' 101, is perfect. It's a rhythm game to bangers from the movie like Hasta La Vista and Too Cool. And I love rhythm games, so I don't have much to say other than it gets two thumbs up. But you know, this is the perfect segue into the next section.
Aw, man, Hannah Montana. That was my absolute jam. Pun intended. The music, the comedy duo of Jackson and Robbie Ray, and sweet niblets Miley and Jake are still one of my favorite enemies to lovers couples to this day. I don't care what you say. Their relationship was infinitely more entertaining to watch than Miley and Jesse, and the writers never should have made Jake cheat on her. Anyway, it's no surprise that the best games in the Hannah Montana section are the rhythm games, but before we go there, I need to talk about the one game that isn't but still offers a rootin' tootin' good time. Jackson's Beach Treat Delivery. That's right, Jackson has a game of his own and it's awesome. Jackson has to serve Miley, Lily, Oliver, and Robbie Ray some sweet treats like a hot fudge sundae, a strawberry milkshake, a vanilla sundae, and a caramel sundae in order to get enough money for a car. It's pretty fast, has smooth controls, throws in enough obstacles to spice things up, and plenty of action to keep me satisfied. We've also got a sandals power-up to make Jackson run faster, yet it surprisingly doesn't protect his feet from crabs, and coins lie around the map for extra tips. They never explain what the ice chests do, but I can only assume they increase the tips since they don't refill what you've spilt. Still, there's plenty of fun to be found here. Proves that Jackson can carry the show and the games on his back when Hannah herself needs a break. As for the rhythm games themselves, I wouldn't expect anything less than fun and rockin', and the Hannah Montana lineup sure delivers. Jammin' with Hannah has her and Jackson practicing songs in their Malibu beach house. You can try your hand at the guitar or drums. Guitar includes an extra mode where you can hold your keyboard and play like an actual guitar, which is an amazing idea on its own, but oh boy, it did not age well. Regardless, I really like this one. It even has a system where your points allow you to unlock more songs, harder game modes, and even a special dance move for both Hannah and Jackson. It keeps you playing longer when you might actually start to get bored of the rhythm. I also have to thank this game for making me realize how awesome Pumping Up the Party and I Got Nerve are. Next we have Rock the Beat, where, oh dang nabbit, what did they do to Hannah? Sorry, I had to get that out of my system. She just looks so freaky, ugh. Ignoring that, Hannah's practicing her dance moves to 8 classic songs. My personal favorites are definitely He Could Be the One and Ice Cream Freeze. As she dances, you have to click the circles at the right time. If you get enough points to clear the level, you'll upgrade from her bedroom to her dressing room and finally the concert stage. You'll need to go all the way for the first half of songs in order to unlock all the cute outfits she has. And although I would have preferred having to press the numbered buttons instead of clicking all the time, it's worth it if I can keep rocking out to some of Hannah's greatest hits. I'd consider Soundboard Mix-Up to be a spiritual successor to Rock the Beat, with better graphics on Hannah's part and the reuse of He Could Be the One, Ice Cream Freeze, and I Wanna Know You. Instead of clicking the numbers, the soundboard is acting strange and you have to press the letter keys that match the knobs that slide on their own. Every song eases into the harder difficulty quite nicely, with each song adding one more key than the one before it. It looks intimidating at first, but it's really not all that bad. It's still fun and not that frustrating compared to earlier entries from other shows. There's also a big difference between practice mode and concert mode, where practice mode has Hannah doing that one move all the time, while concert mode shows her making a more dynamic performance in her dancing. Additionally, concert mode is the only one that requires use of the spacebar. And since Rock the Beat takes place in Season 3, it makes sense that the soundboard mix-up game takes place in Season 4 to allow for other songs like Are You Ready?, I'm Still Good?, and Que Será to shine. I'll say this much though, there's a noticeable difference in quality between the menus Are You Ready? And the gameplays Are You Ready? Put on your coolest dress and your hottest pair of shoes, come on let's go! Put on your coolest dress and your hottest pair of shoes, come on let's go! Surprise! I'm not done with Zack and Cody games yet! What better way to end this section than with what I started, right? This is my chance to cover the one Sweet Life on Deck game I was obsessed with, Longa Conga. It plays out like a game of Snake, but you're on the Fiesta deck assembling your own conga line so Mosby doesn't notice you're late for class. In addition to Zach, Cody, and London, you can also play as Bailey or Woody. I could play this for hours if I wanted to. It's one of my favorite Snake games, right up there with Picnic from Webkinz. But you know what's the best part? If you collect all your friends, you go to the bonus round. Suddenly, the Fiesta deck is no more. Now, there's only disco. Neon lights? Funky fresh beats? This is exactly what a Fiesta should be! Whether you think Sweet Life on Deck holds up to the original or not, this game stands out quite well. Phew! You feel that? We're halfway through my longest video yet, so don't go anywhere. We must march onward and continue trekking through the nostalgia. Following the Disney trend, I say we go back to when we were really little, because let's be honest, the preschooler sites were most likely our first exposure to the world of gaming. Out of the big three, the Playhouse Disney website is the one I don't have that many memories of despite enjoying it overall. In comparison to the other two, their games felt pretty lackluster, but when they struck gold, man, they were good. Unfortunately, none of the Bear in the Big Blue House ones are going to be mentioned, even though that was the ultimate Playhouse Disney show and one of the best preschool shows of all time. Charlie and Lola was one of my favorite Playhouse Disney shows. Its art style is rather unique, and the characters themselves are quite charming. Besides, Charlie gets brownie points for raising Lola on his own while he's clearly a young kid himself. There's this interactive book called I Will Not Ever Never Eat That Lunch where Lola won't eat her food, so Charlie has to convince her they're fun, otherworldly objects because he's a good brother who won't let his little sister starve herself. This is a standout among interactive book activities because instead of strictly following the original episode's plot, it's a choose-your-own-adventure type of deal. Alongside Charlie's canon suggestions, each food has an alternative option, like turning the carrot into a turbocharged super racer instead of an orange twiglet from Jupiter. And between Charlie's "but Lola, those aren't bits," you get to decorate the imagination sequence. The book even acknowledges your choices at the end by having Lola take Charlie for a ride in the carrot option you picked. They keep the decorations you put on Charlie's carrot too, which I think is an especially nice touch. The PB&J Otter interactive book isn't much and thus happens to be one of the vaguer memories, but I loved it solely because if you saw a prompt for one of the three kids, you could click them to trigger a special event. I got a kick out of spamming Jelly just to see her noodle dance across the screen for a brief second. The Roly Poly Oly interactive book, Coochie and Koo and the Forever Family, is super cute. It tells a story about Oly and his family finding these two roly-poly babies and trying to find their parents. But they discover the babies are orphans, so they adopt them and oh my goodness, it's so sweet! The realistic baby noises definitely up the cuteness factor. I mean, just listen to these! I know they're just the generic ones used in games like Let's Babysit Baby Chrissy, but still, how could you not melt at the roly-poly babies? Also, this moment is hilarious out of context.
Make your wish, Oly, said Zoe. I wish we knew where those babies came from.
Higglytown Heroes was another good show, and it has yet another interactive book I find rather nostalgic, and man, Playhouse Disney really knew how to make great interactive books, didn't they? Higgly Beach or Bust is a story narrated by Yubi. The kids and Fran go to the beach after their splash in the inflatable kiddie pool is too strong for it to handle. And let me tell you, this show may be wholesome for the most part, but this moment must have awoken someone's vor fetish and I don't like those implications. Anyway, Wayne's mom decides to take them to the beach after you pick three hidden objects. They have five on screen at once just in case, but you can't actually pick all five before Yubi moves on. Before they can get there, the car suffers from a flat tire! Naturally, Twinkle comes up with an imaginative yet outlandish solution and the book briefly turns into Mad Libs. Just like how her crazy ideas are the best part of each episode, it's the best part of the book! I always liked picking the polka dot pig with either bouncy feet or fairy wings, but I don't remember which bubblegum I'd give her. Aside from it being not lemon, because that's plain gross. Of course, Twinkle's plan to get a special animal to blow a tire out of bubblegum is impossible because aside from everyone being nesting dolls, they're fairly grounded in reality, so a tow truck driver takes them and fixes the flat tire instead. And around here is where the audio suddenly lowers quality in a similar fashion to Hannah Montana's soundboard mix-up, which is my one complaint for the whole thing.
Every time you get in the car, and you'll also be a
Higglytown Hero!
Regardless, playing this again made me realize how wholesome it is that the ordinary people in our lives can be heroes too. Grocery A-Go-Go is one of the better games on the site, and I think it has a great aesthetic. You have to help the kids get everything on their shopping list before the store closes, from milk to sausages to bread and what I can assume are tuna cans and laundry detergent. Look at how bright and colorful everything is! Even the sound effects feel quite vibrant.
Bingo! Yeah! Radio.
Once again, the audio sometimes varies in quality, but interestingly, despite the increase in difficulty, I did worst on level 2, while levels 1 and 3 were the exact same score. I've never had that happen before. When I think back on JoJo Circus, I think that shows one of the biggest reasons I love clowns. Heck, I dressed up as JoJo for Halloween once. I used to think I was the only kid who actually liked clowns since most of my friends were scared of them, so I appreciate JoJo for spreading clown positivity. Thankfully, her games are just as silly as a circus. JoJo's Jungling Jumble is oddly satisfying if you have a good sense of rhythm. It has similar vibes to Grocery A-Go-Go, but with no stakes. Big Top Snack Hop is essentially a Frogger clone, but easier, and JoJo doesn't die if she makes a wrong move. You have to deliver circus snacks like ice cream, popcorn, and peanuts to Trina, Goliath, Croaky, and Skibo without touching the ground. It's big fun, and I like Frogger, so it gets a pass. JoJo's Circus Train is one of the most interesting 3-in-1s on a fundamental level. When comparing to Crypto the Superdog's Heroes Unite, which has three separate games with similar mechanics, JoJo's Circus Train consists of a game, a click-along, and a play-along. Skibo Says is a neat little Simon Says type of game, but probably my least favorite when it comes to Simon Says clones because of how slow he gives his commands. It's surprisingly hard to recognize after 5 minutes! Silly Hilly Express, on the other hand, is closer to a virtual toy, but delivers on the silly goodness its name promises. Just look.
Jump, chugga, jump, chugga, jump, chugga, 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 spin, 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 chugga.
And Choo Choo Yu has the computer make the patterns for the characters while the player moves around their room to match the movements. I don't think I actually followed along as a kid, but I enjoyed watching them go up and down the hill. Finally, my favorite JoJo Circus game just so happens to be one that Flashpoint doesn't have. Jumpin' JoJo. It's a jump rope game with only one song I remember doing in my real-life childhood, Ice Cream Soda. And wow, how come all of the best songs have to do with ice cream so far? First Hannah Montana and now this! But nonetheless, I'm a sucker for rhythm games, and this is no exception. Now that I think of it, there aren't a lot of jump rope games I've played aside from this one and Jump Rope from Mario Party 8, which is a shame because I dig it. For now, Jumpin' JoJo has the top spot for JoJo Circus games and jump rope games, which I consider quite a feat. Oh man, oh man, Doodlebops is such a throwback! It's basically the Wiggles' successor, but if the weirdness came from the characters themselves rather than the places they visited. And now I'm realizing just how much I forgot about the Playhouse Disney games! So there's only one game I remember from this, and it's Get on the Bus. Think Polly Pocket's drive-in style, but if you're collecting music notes and equipment instead of cute outfits and replace the time limit with obstacles. It's cute. I like it. You know what else is cute? Johnny and the Sprites. It'd honestly be a dream come true to live in the forest near a whole civilization of fairies and play with them and maybe sing a little. Speaking of singing, the one game I actually remember is Sprite Tag Songbook, and it's my absolute jam. You have to click on all the sprites that appear on the screen, and you have until the song you picked finishes. It's a good reminder of how banging the theme song and Heads Up are, and a neat little reflex tester. It's definitely one of my favorites from the Playhouse Disney website.
Nobody else sees us, it's true.
There's only Johnny, and now there's you.
Heads up! Keep a lookout for a crazy day. Heads up! Keep an eye out for a game to play.
I remember watching Little Einsteins before it became a huge meme last decade. Their games match the show's focus on music, with Silly Song Machine having the kids make funny noises to classic orchestral pieces and countless games where June dances. They're probably the games I have the least to discuss about, but for what they are, they're harmless child's play and good for any kid who's really into music. Real talk, does anybody remember Bunnytown? I almost forgot about it, but thank goodness I didn't! I liked Bunnytown! Just puppet bunnies having fun doing random things. Now that's genius! Not to mention the website went all out in making it a pseudo-virtual world type of deal. You could make your own bunny, give it a home, and earn carrots to spend for more decorations or clothes. But we're not here to discuss virtual worlds, we're here to discuss nostalgic Flash games, so let's just focus on the Bunnytown games that stood out to me, okay? Here we have two. Ice Cream Parlor and do the Bunny Town Hop. Ice Cream Parlor is very simple yet surprisingly satisfying to play. I mean, when you serve the bunnies the ice cream flavors they want, it just feels good. Bonus points go to the flavors for being mostly alliterative. Blueberry Blast, Purple Berry Pie, Green Lickety Lime, Pink Strawberry Swirl. And believe me, if the game sounds good now, wait until I discuss another beloved ice cream game later on. Then we have Do the Bunny Town Hop, which has your bunny dance to the classic Bunny Town Hop song by clicking on a variety of different moves. It's less satisfying when you watch the bunny dance because it's a bit offbeat.
Bend your knees. Make bunny ears. Pat your head. Spin around.
But in the moment when you're improvising the moves, it's not half bad. I like it. So, The Book of Pooh is a show I don't remember watching all too often. But hey, it's Winnie the Pooh, so it was probably nothing short of sweet and wholesome. Not to mention, Tigger totally rocks the puppet look. It fits him like a glove. Despite this, I inexplicably could never forget the Connect the Letters game. I can't find it on Flashpoint, but the clips I found only had sound effects, even though I could have sworn some weird voice shouted out all the letters. I'd definitely consider Tigger's shadow shapes from My Friends Tigger and Pooh an upgrade. Here, you match characters and objects with the rebelling shadows until time runs out. The spike in difficulty is definitely noticeable, especially when your mouse runs out of battery and you have to play with a touchpad instead. But even with the mouse, when you reach the last level, it's not as easy as it looks. That impresses me. There's this one Mickey Mouse Clubhouse game where you go fishing and make a rainbow. It's called Donald's Gone Gooey Fishing, which is perfect because the fish all look like gummy Swedish fish candies. The only reason I remember this game is because of the pink eraser fish, which gets rid of the colors you've collected so far should you catch it. Somehow, it never left my mind the same way Collect the Letters didn't. The game itself actually isn't too bad. I like fishing games like this. It has an arcade feel to it, so I consider it an instant win. Oh boy, the Handy Manny games were something else. Watch Out Mr. Lopart is a bit of a weird one where Mr. Lopart is carrying boxes as an auto-scroll while you have to clear the path for him by getting rid of garbage and feeding stray chihuahuas. It feels like I'm on autopilot when I play this, but I don't mean that in a bad way. If you get what I mean. Meanwhile, I was the fastest draw in the West with Fix It Fetch. Nothing matters aside from getting as many points as possible, and I love the pure insanity that ensues. But I can't explain my love for Hop Up Jump In. Bounce and catch games are super fun to me. Simple as that. If there's one thing that stands out about the Playhouse Disney games, it's that the interstitials have their own games as well. Captain Carlos in Snack Power has Carlos playing soccer and trying to score a goal, so he collects yummy healthy snacks while avoiding the junk food his sister is obsessed with. The more healthy food he collects, the higher he can jump and the faster he can run. Collecting snack power bonuses will also tell you facts about some of the food options. I think this might have been where I learned about how carrots can help with eyesight. The jumping can be a little tight sometimes, which could make it difficult to avoid the junk food on the ground, but there's plenty of other food to collect before the timer runs out. And apparently, even when you have a low score, Carlos can still make the goal, so there's practically no stakes if you collect too much junk food. On the other hand, Lou and You shifts the focus from healthy eating to safety habits, which justifies the existence of a Find the Safety Violation game. Each scenario they present is a bit randomized for which violation they'll give you to spot, and this demonstrates that there's at least three different ways to put yourself in danger, whether it be minor inconveniencing or life-threatening. Even though they don't state it outright, some of these can be a bit scary for adults to think about, especially if their children are in these situations. In a surprising turn of events, it's the hosts that have the best games here. And I'm not talking about Clay, who despite being adorable, I completely forgot existed before filming this video. No. I'm talking about Monkey Puppets Ooh and Ah. There's three of them I remember vividly. An interactive story, a bowling game, and a costumed vine-swinging game. The interactive story is about Ah dreaming about his birthday, which is the next day. He wants his own pet that you can pick out of three options. He'd love the pet even more if it sounded like whatever wild animal you picked. I was a duck crow main, but I did pick the bunny once. Also, it doesn't matter what sound you pick since at the end of the story, the pet you pick for Ah makes all three sounds. It's a little less immersive than the other interactive books because of this, but it's still pretty charming. At least it makes up for it with a couple mini-games, so you can at least see it as a nice hide-and-seek and tick-face-toe bundle game with extra content. Coconutty Bowling is more up to speed since it's an actual game. You play as both monkeys, and you gotta collect as many points as you can without letting your ball get eaten by any of the coconut masks. Combine both of their points together and you get a grand trophy. Though they will say you did most of the legwork because of whatever witchcraft you cast on the ball, so that's extra nice of them to say your bowling skills are a double-decker banana split cream pie with a knit on top. Finally, costume catch is my favorite. You play as either one of the monkeys and you catch as many costumes as you can in high-speed thrills. The commentary varies depending on which one you play as, since the other will say different things about your costumes. I especially remember there being a gentleman costume, a king costume, and a clown costume. Also, kudos to these two for making sure JoJo Circus wasn't the only thing spreading clown positivity. Here's a fun fact about me. Most people who grew up with PBS Kids say it's because they didn't have cable. I had cable, and I chose to watch PBS Kids. I was hooked on Sesame Street, Clifford, Arthur, Dragon Tales, Maya and Miguel, Sagwa the Siamese Cat, and Word Girl. And I would have loved Cyber Chase if they put it in the right time slot because come on! The combination of animation and the digital world is totally my aesthetic. Strangely, looking back on this site, usually there's only one or two games per show that I remember playing all the time, with a couple exceptions. That doesn't mean they were the only ones I played, just the ones whose memories are still pretty fresh in my mind. Let's be honest, Clifford the Big Red Dog hits different than most PBS Kids shows. Is it any surprise that this and Sesame Street ruled the network? The only game I really remember playing in the Clifford section is Clifford Slide. Clifford Slide is more of a virtual toy than a game, but it's really nice. Emily Elizabeth and her friends are going swimming, so Clifford's back is being used by them as a slide. Each character has a color associated with their bathing suit, and you have to click the life preserver that matches. I always found it funny when Jetta's dog Max slid down. He looked happy, but then when he swam away, his eyes seemed grumpy. Jumping Boos is also more of a virtual toy. This one involves the Boobas, one of two PBS Kids shows where they're too mindless to show your kids too often, yet as an adult, it's a free drug trip without the side effects. All of the Boobas games are virtual toys, and in Jumping Boos, bongo music plays on loop while the Boobas walk in place and colorful bubbles appear above them. Each bubble is color-coded to match a booba, so your job is to click on them to make them fart jump and grab it as a chorus of kids announces their name. This is the only way I managed to remember three of the five boobas' names. Jumba, Jingba, and Zing Zing Zingba! I still have my dancing Jingba toy, by the way. Back on track, it's definitely a step up from Look What I Can Do, which is just a dance game. The only perks are you can customize your character, and no matter when you click the dance button, the Look What I Can Do sound always perfectly syncs up with the music. They're great turn-off-your-brain games. The one Word Girl game I played the most was Power Words, where Word Girl is in some kind of trouble and you have to pick the right word to help her save the day or herself. Just like the show, Power Words does a great job at expanding a child's vocabulary. With words like disintegrate, disentangle, and promenade, I wouldn't be surprised if a kid spoke more eloquently after playing this. As for the situations, they're well set up. The one where she has to save Captain Huggy Face from Chuck the Evil Sandwich Making Guy's sandwich press made me too scared to click anything other than rescue for obvious reasons. Now, Dragon Tales is an interesting case. The show is so calming that you can fall asleep to it, and I mean that in a good way. Also, not to brag, but my mom used to make a great Zack impression. It's adorable, and so are the two games I remember. Dragon Tunes has you pick between Cassie, Ord, Zack and Wheezy, and Quetzal to watch a 2-second looping gif of them dancing to whatever song from the show you picked. It's definitely nothing more than a virtual toy. A fun one, but still. The other game, Share a Song, gives you more to do. You can pick between 3 songs, assign them to a dragon of your choice, and fill in blanks to either adhere to the original song or make them silly. My favorite route was picking Cassie and staying true to the Cassie Had a Little Lamb song, but I also adore any rendition of The Wheels on the Bus from Zack and Wheezy. Now that we're on the subject, Cassie is still my favorite dragon because she's so darn sweet and adorable, not to mention I got a plush of her when I watched Dragon Tales live once. But Wheezy speaks to me on a whole new level. I adore her hyper energy, not to mention her and Zack's harmonies are on point.
The toy box on the bus goes open and shut. Open and shut. Open and shut.
And I just realized I barely gave any love to Ord, so I'm just gonna be honest. He looks like he gives the best hugs and I'm all for it. Seriously, the only dragon who could rival him is Quetzal. Anyway, I'm moving on from this tangent. Back to the games. The Sagwa the Siamese Cat games definitely catered to me. Very much a choose-your-own-adventure type of deal. The two I played most often were the ones where you decided which toys to give the cats and what meal Cook should make for the magistrate. The toys were pretty cool because Sagwa would give the same commentary for them regardless of which one you gave which cat, but the animations would vary. For example, if you gave Shigwa the Tuo Lo spinning top, it would travel not as far before recoiling and go slower than if you gave it to Sagwa just like she said. Interestingly, Dagwa and Shigwa's toys never overlap with each other, but when you pick a toy for Sagwa, you could choose between the two options you didn't pick for either of her siblings. After a lot of experimenting, my favorite choices were and still are the Chimsit toy for Dagwa, the Twirlo game for Shigwa, and the Niao game for Sagwa, mainly because of how each one was described with that specific cat in mind. There was actually an alternate version of this I completely forgot about, where you could assign different art activities for them to do. The shadow puppet icon unlocked that deeply hidden memory. Although I like the toy one a tiny bit better since there's a designated favorite toy for each cat. As for the food game, the meals you could pick to give the magistrate looked delicious. I could only imagine eating the binger cake, chow su dumplings, wontons of pork or chicken or shrimp, Sagwa is a lady of culture considering the shrimp wontons are her favorite, and mooncakes. Yeah, it's pretty obvious this game makes me hungry. Look, I liked Caillou as a kid, and I'm willing to admit it aged like milk, but you can't deny the theme song's pretty great.
I'm just a kid who's four, each day I grow some more. I like exploring, I'm Caillou.
Meanwhile, the games are the exact opposite of the show. Caillou is so different here, which is really weird. It's one thing to not be whining and screaming all the time, but he sounds a lot less pitchy too. I think this is who Caillou was meant to be. I mean, look at these clips back to back and tell me they sound the same.
Silly old car! Silly, silly, silly!
Hello, I'm very happy to see you.
The dollhouse one was my favorite. In this one, you have to help Caillou design a new dollhouse for Rosie. I love how genuinely excited he is to make something nice for his little sister. It's very sweet. The objects you put inside the house are cute too, and when you're done, you can see the different family members interacting with the stuff you picked. The only downside is that they play only one animation per family member, so a lot of props end up going unused in your final result. Thankfully, you can redo the dollhouse to see who uses the other props. There's also this one cooking game where you have to pick out the right ingredients for the recipe Caillou and his grandma plan to cook. When you pick the wrong ingredients, you actually get to see a picture of what it would look like even though it never actually gets made. I remember at some point making a hamburger with spaghetti noodles in it and chocolate-flavored buns. Aside from the chocolate buns, it actually sounds quite yummy, especially since mac and cheeseburgers exist and they're amazing. I couldn't get that combo during my playthrough, but I did get a fruity pizza, chocolate tuna with spaghetti and corn, and fajitas with chocolate tortillas. Yes, I love chocolate. What of it? Sure, many of the messed up combos sound like nightmares only pregnant ladies would crave, but those three sound genuinely delicious. The only other game I remember from the Caillou lineup is the dinosaur fossil hunting one, only because of Caillou saying, "Great, now we know what our dinosaur looks like," when you assemble the bones together and watch a short clip from when the dino was still alive. It's cute, but a bit repetitive. Jakers! The Adventures of Pigglywinks has games that are the definition of fun but look scary. Look at these graphics. They kept the CGI look, and gameplay mechanics aside, they look like fucking nightmares. Thankfully, they're easier to look at the further we delve into them. Egg Collector even sounds nightmarish because of the chickens. Those do not sound like chickens. It's weird because they sound normal in Seesaw Hee-Haws. But long story short, Egg Collector is surprisingly hard yet entertaining. Seesaw Hee-Haws is funny because of the way the animals look and sound, as well as Danon's celebratory screeches. And Jamming with Wily takes the cake as the best Jakers game because it's a relaxing music game. Or it would have been if it wasn't for Wily's hilarious dancing. Sure, it looks weird, but not in a scary way. And I like how easy it is to freestyle with the bongos. The coloring book, though, is a definite standout because it's not your ordinary coloring book. After you color everything in, your characters can perform little animations, and in CGI, no less. Not bad at all. Too bad I couldn't figure out how to make it work on Flashpoint, so maybe that last bit is just the Mandela effect taking place. But I digress. If there's any PBS kids show whose games I remember really well, it's definitely Arthur by a long shot. And why wouldn't it be? Arthur is a staple of PBS Kids, having ran for 25 seasons before going into retirement this year. 25 seasons comes with a wide variety of games to discuss. Don't Wait, Kate is basically a Minesweeper slash Pathfinder type of game, and it scared me when I was little. I'm less scared of it now, but I still don't like it. Part of it is memory, part of it is randomization of where the toys are after each turn. It still somewhat holds up in the scare factor because trying to be quiet while getting a drink in the middle of the night is an anxiety-inducing experience. Though at least it's not downright unsettling, well, aside from the game over screen, because goodness gracious, Baby Kate moves so unnaturally!
What the actual shit? What?
But you know what is? The Virtual Goose Game. I'm pretty sure I never made it to the end when I was little. And as if the difficulty wasn't bad enough, the audio is way too loud on the screeching goose. I turned off the music just to give you guys a taste of how loud this thing really is. Oh, and did I mention? This game is hard. I'm lucky I got past Suellen on my first try because mentally rotating the options helps with pattern recognition, but that next round screwed my mind so badly because of how similar they were for once. Thank goodness I don't seem to be timed, because I literally had to look at my options in a different angle during that last round to take down Sass Queen DW. Despite the weirdness, I like it better now than when I was little. But it's time we move on to the not-so-terrifying stuff. Muffy's Wardrobe is a dress-up game with a twist. You have to dress her up for specific events, so if you don't get the outfit completely correct, Muffy will tell you how many parts you got wrong. And when you get her outfit right, you're rewarded with a bonus picture of her actually doing the thing. The ballet one must be cathartic for a lot of DW haters. Meanwhile, I just find it funny despite DW being my favorite character. My favorite pictures are of the basketball game where Muffy's using her butler to score a point, and the beach trip where she's burning her feet off while DW buries Arthur alive in the sand. The beach picture is pure chaos, and I love it. I also appreciate that they added extra outfits not correlating to any event, like this clown suit. Doesn't she look cute? Speaking of Muffy, she's one of the people you can choose from in About Face. She, DW, Buster, Francine, and Binky have stories that Arthur wants to share with his dog. DW celebrates her birthday, Muffy donates her dolls to charity, Buster needs to find a replacement object for show and tell, Francine embarrasses herself at a soccer match, and Binky finds a new ballet show to enjoy. If you guess the right emotion they're experiencing at certain parts of the story, Pal gets a bone. This is a great way to teach kids how to recognize feelings. Kudos to the developers for a job well done. Also, Muffy's a fan of the Backstreet Boys. Who knew? There's this one game, Buster's Movie Maker, where Buster makes a movie about Arthur's birthday. Arthur receives a gift from someone at the door, but the event is executed differently depending on what adjective is in the title. The movie doesn't quite align with the title, so you have to click on the sounds, the person, and the present that matches up better. They will always say your version is better no matter which options you go for, but I still played by the rules and only went with what makes sense. For example, in Arthur's Happy Movie, I'd never pick anything other than the ice cream truck and gourmet ice cream that looks like it came from Mr. Softy, which I really want to get ice cream from someday because I can't believe an ice cream truck could actually give out store-quality hot fudge sundaes. Oh, and since we're on the topic of Buster-themed games, I can't forget Alien, Assembly Required, where you create an alien friend for Buster. It's actually kind of sweet considering how much he loves aliens. If I had to pick a favorite from the Arthur games, it'd probably be the Tibble Super Action Challenge where those twin boys, Tommy and Timmy Tibbles, would face off dressed up as wrestlers while you answer trivia questions. I liked proving to myself how well I really knew Arthur, and the setting provided a sweet cherry on top, complete with DW as the referee and questioner. I like seeing her in that role. I'll say, I'm surprised I did so well until the last round, but it's a mix of great memory and luck. Maya and Miguel's games were few and far between as far as I remember, but they were still fun. The Adventure Scrapbook series has you pick between Maya, Miguel, Chrissy, and Theo to take pictures based on scenarios from pre-existing episodes. The highlighted word is what you need to take a picture of. When you finish, you're complimented for your skills before putting your pictures in a scrapbook, topped with an offer to go on another adventure. It's not much, but thankfully World of Sports compensates for it. You have 5 different games, each one based on a sport like ping pong, soccer, and boomerang. They're simple sports games, but charming in their own way. Ping pong with Theo is my personal favorite. Not only is it my favorite sport of these options in real life, but I find the sounds really satisfying. The same thing applies to boomerang with Andy. But if any of these didn't age well, it's soccer with Miguel.
The angles make it hard to tell where Miguel will aim the ball, and I kid you not, my first play in years ended with a grand total of 0. But for what they're worth, World of Sports is a pretty good series. Okay, one more before we move on to our last section. Do you guys remember that crossover game between Arthur and Maya and Miguel? I do. It's a fanfiction prompt generator, and it's glorious! It's also where that cursed gooey Binky photo came from. You can choose to have Buster or Maya help you with the story, or you can have complete creative freedom that gives the human race way too much power by removing the swear filters. I have no idea what they were thinking by doing this, but I'm thankful because chaos. The complete creative freedom also provided a great test of my improv skills. I took the one story that I liked the most, didn't use any of Buster's help, and wrote a whole 6-page story based on one picture in less than 5 minutes. Younger me could never. And finally, I've saved the best games for last. Out of the big 3 preschooler network websites, Nick Jr. will forever be the reigning champion. Top-notch quality all around. I feel like I have the most to gush about here, so buckle up, cause we're about to take off and cover this ultra-nostalgic goldmine in all its glory. Of course, we gotta start with the biggest star of my childhood, Dora the Explorer. I still have a soft spot for her, even though I'm willing to acknowledge she didn't age as well as most of her peers. That theme still slaps hard though, and I can't believe we collectively forgot how funny she can be sometimes. Also, who knew a show about a girl living in a computer game would work beautifully as an actual computer game? I mean, at the very least, nobody'd complain about the long, awkward pauses anymore. Dora's Mermaid Adventure is definitely the one I remember the most, and it's based on the season 4 finale, Dora Saves the Mermaids, which is the last Dora episode I remember watching. This game consists of 2 phases. The first half is Dora cleaning on the beach, while the second half has Dora turning into a mermaid and cleaning the garbage underwater. If you click and hold the mouse, she slows down and you can get all the garbage by shining the light on it. But if you let go and don't have good control over her, she runs at supersonic speed until she reaches the end of the screen. I'd always be careful when letting go, since if you let her run too far, you won't be able to grab the garbage she passed. There's also some garbage that pops out at the last minute with a tight space, so beware those creatures if you want to get a 100% score. La Casa de Dora is a game I completely forgot, but the music portion brought me back. We got the bongo, half bongo, guitar, maracas, and guiro. Pick one of 4 different tunes for each and make your own music. I like clicking around on the stuff that doesn't activate games either, like Dora's family members, pictures, or the cute little toys in Dora's room. Speaking of cute, check out the flowers you can plant in Dora's garden. Perrito is automatically cute too, because he's a dog. Anybody remember the Nick Arcade? Because their Dora game stayed fresh in my mind. I only played a free trial of Dora's Starcatcher and Dora's Candyland, but both were pretty good. Of course, reflex testers like Dora's Starcatcher should be added to the list of game types I absolutely love, but it's also way too short as it consists of only one level. And Dora's Candyland is something I can at least appreciate since it allows you to disable backwards moves. Or at least I thought it did, but I can't find that option from the menu anymore. Candyland is a little less chaotic that way, but at least it makes for a mostly frustration-free game. Really, it all boils down to picking your poison. Mind you, Candyland was one of my favorite board games when I was little, so I'm a bit biased. Dora's Fairy Tale Fiesta is an interactive book where Dora is a princess and she and Boots are invited to a royal party. But an evil witch who hates parties casts a spell to make the castle float away, so Dora has to make her way to the clouds and find the king and queen. Throughout her journey, she helps iconic fairy tale characters like the 7 dwarves and the 3 little pigs, and she even meets Jack and the Giant. Similar to the Playhouse Disney interactive books, you're given tasks to do like finding the dwarves and fixing the pigs' house. And if you move your cursor on specific things, you'll activate special little animations. My favorite's the witch, who always says, "Voila, broomstick! Fly!" no matter what page you find her on. We also get a bombshell of a twist about the party-hating witch. She hates parties because she's never been invited to one! But everyone's invited to the royal fiesta, so the witch seizes her attacks and ends up having a great time. What a nice story. Dora's Carnival Adventure, though, is top 2 material among Dora games. I forgot about many of the mini-games here, like Boots' Claw Machine and Air Hockey with Swiper, but more deep memories were unlocked with the Slip and Slide and Bumper Cars games.
I also couldn't forget that infuriating color wheel game, or the Pac-Man clone known as Roberto's Bubble Game. So basically, Dora's Carnival Adventure simulates going to the carnival and provides pretty good escapism when it isn't summertime. You play games at the carnival to win tickets and get neat little prizes for your toy box. The bumper cars are my favorite carnival game because of the absolute chaos. You can knock the cars all the way to the opposite side of the screen if you hit them hard enough. It's surprisingly cathartic. However, the hitbox is jankier than I remember. Air Hockey with Swiper suffers from the same problem. The puck kept clipping behind me. Roberto's Bubble Game is a close second, though. As a kid, I'd play that one the most, and it holds up extra well today because of how smooth and fast it runs. It reminds me of the Pac-Man Galaga hybrid arcade machines at my local movie theaters, which I consider the superior versions of both games since they provide the high-speed thrills I crave so badly. But the best part of Dora's Carnival Adventure is that you can actually play with your prizes. If a kid wanted to go to a carnival but couldn't, this is what makes it the perfect alternative. My personal favorites are the Spinning Top and Swiper in the Box. I'm surprised the Swiper in the Box didn't become a real toy, because aside from the switching outfits, this would have been nice to have as a kid. I already own Classic and Sock Monkey Jack in the Boxes, so not making a Swiper version with that banging music is a missed opportunity. The sequel, which changes the location to a beach boardwalk, is unfortunately a downgrade. The new games are way too simple, but the return of Air Hockey with Swiper and Thirsty Dolphins at least make improvements from the first Carnival Adventure. The latter is a lot sleeker and smoother, while the former avoids the problem of the puck clipping through. I also found myself enjoying the Bongos prize quite a bit. Speaking of Swiper, I find it funny that the other best Dora game doesn't even have Dora in it. That's right, I'm talking about Swiper the Explorer. In this one, Swiper's own creation, a robot butterfly, steals all his toys, so you have to help him get them back while taking down mini robot butterflies and caterpillars. It's apparently based on an episode I never watched where the robot butterfly he creates swipes his stuff and strips him down, which is quite wild for a preschool show. The point-and-click mechanics are nice, not to mention the keyboard is a thoughtful alternative if the point-and-click method is too slippery for some, but the dialogue is a bit clunky. Swiper seems to shout a little too often, and his instructions are incredibly hand-holding. Like, come on, younger me already figured out how to defeat the final boss before he spelled everything out. Regardless, it was fun playing as Swiper for once. I'm also surprised by how hard it is to 100% this. I mean, a lot of the butterflies hide off-screen to the point where once you see them, it's too late, so it's easy to bump into them. In the end, I think Swiper's become my favorite Dora character, so you can tell this was quite the bonding experience. Dora's cousin Diego also has a handful of good games. The music slaps way harder than the Dora games too, so good for him. I love Diego's Dinosaur Adventure the most. You play through three different mini-games, each one ending with Diego digging up dinosaur bones. The egg collecting one is still the best of the game, solely because it's so much fun to speedrun it and call yourself the fastest draw in the West. That means also hitting rocks, flowers, and baby dinosaurs when necessary.
Something touch me!
The caretaking portion is pretty nice, but I'll always find it funny that the teenage dinos have earbuds and an iPod. Wearing clothes like a little hat and maybe a shirt sounds fine enough, but that's just absurd. And finally, the maze works very well. The map is a great layout and it's easy to collect everything before you reach the end. Diego's snowboard rescue was also pretty good. It's kind of like Barbie's half-pipe pixie, but you have to reach a specific distance and the camera is using a different angle. In fact, it's the opposite of Run Jerry Run as far as camera angles go. My one complaint is that when Diego jumps, you can't move him until he hits the ground again. This makes a few animals easy to miss. And as a counterpart to Dora's Mermaid Adventure, Diego Safari Rescue is based on an episode where a group of elephants are turned to stone by a mosquito-turned-witch. Diego uses a magic bongo to free all the cursed animals, which you identify by clicking on the glowing objects and later matching a bongo pattern. Save all the animals and you unlock a neat Simon Says game with the bongo, which is definitely a step up from Skibo Says. One I completely forgot about was Rainforest Adventure, one of Diego's first games. You run across the rainforest with the funniest walk cycle I've seen out of all of the games mentioned in this video. And have to look for all the animals in the pictures lined up on the left side of the screen while avoiding the Bobo brothers throwing banana peels at you every 5 seconds. Was that a lot to take in? I thought so. When you finish, you have to get back to the Animal Rescue Center before the rest of your time runs out. I love the power-ups they offer. One turns the rescue pack into a hang glider that allows you to fly all over and collect a lot of points, and the other is fruit that allows Diego to run at sonic speed and only makes the walk cycle even more hilarious. Rainforest Adventure is worth playing for that alone. Really, it's great. Not gonna lie, the Wow Wow Wubsy games are some of the games that aged the best. Admittedly, I'm not too into Widget's Robots or Walden's Dress-Up nowadays, since the first is a simple assembly game while the second is a typical dress-up game that I don't have much to discuss. However, Wubsy's Wow Wow Ring Catch, Wubsy's Amazing Adventure, and Wubsy's Underwater Adventure hold up really well. This is exactly how I remember the game, as a bestie trio. Not that I dislike Daisy, but I have zero attachment to her whatsoever because I stopped watching Nick Jr. sometime in 2008, early enough to have no clue that they added a new girl by the time I saw her face on a Chuck E. Cheese TV screen. But that's off topic. Wubsy's Wow Wow Ring Catch was one of the first Wubsy games made for the website, and it's a good first impression. You have to get as many points as possible before time runs out, and you do this by collecting rings with Wubsy's tail and bouncing a kickity kickball off his head for extra combo points. I also admire the spike in difficulty for later levels, where they introduce items you have to avoid and the rings begin wiggling around, making them harder to catch compared to when they fall straight down. Although, the last level makes it too easy for point grinding because of how many balls fall down from the screen, but maybe that's the point. To make the last level extra celebratory. Either way, it's a lot of fun collecting all these things and avoiding the acorns and books. Getting a perfect score is impossible, but as long as you score at least 100 points per level and don't get hit by anything, you'll be fine. Wubsy's Amazing Adventure is inspired by A Tale of Tales, the first Wow Wow Wubsy episode. Widget's RoboClick 3000 goes haywire, so it's up to Wubsy to find it and shut it down. This game really is amazing because of the difficulty. Sure, finishing is easy, but 100%ing it isn't. It's like Crash Bandicoot. You have to be very precise with your moves in order to avoid getting hit by the enemies. I also discovered while replaying that if you backtrack far enough before going forward again, the eggs and baby chick bots will respawn with the eggs repeating the exact same formation from that attack. That's insane! Wubsy's Underwater Adventure is a worthy sequel. In this one, Walden tells Wubsy and Widget the tragic story of Wuzlantis, an underwater kingdom turned to stone by the evil Snappity Snapfish, and the trio decide to have Wubsy travel in a submarine, face off against the Snappity Snapfish, and save Wuzlantis. This game improves the mechanics of Wubsy's Amazing Adventure ever so slightly. Instead of jumping and dodging as you walk side to side, you can now go to all parts of the screen and even fight back against your enemies by trapping them in bubbles. Whether or not it's easier to get a perfect score here is up for debate, because the floaty movements might be just as difficult to manage as the sharp precision from the first game. Not to mention, there are a lot more areas that make it impossible to backtrack for any points you missed. And the final level's fish skeletons make it necessary to squeeze through tight gaps to stop Wubsy from bumping into them and losing points. Despite these potential setbacks, Wubsy's Underwater Adventure brims with more personality since you have a full conversation between the trio as well as unique music to fit with the underwater atmosphere. Compare this to Wubsy's Amazing Adventure, which reuses instrumental tracks from the show as its background music.
Everyone's at the pet party.
And Wubsy can barely get much conversation in with Widget or Walden before each level starts. Really, the only criticism I have here is that their mouths don't line up with their voices well. It makes the game production look cheaper than usual, but it doesn't mean it's any less enjoyable. Who could forget the LazyTown ones? They're classics. From the Superhero Challenge and Sports Candy Sprint board games to Get Up and Move, these were great. Not to mention, the latter two did a great job at rigging the live-action characters rather than convert them to 2D animation like Superhero Challenge did. Also, in all of these games, I was a Stephanie main. She's still best girl, and she invented neon pink hair. That queen's the reason I have neon pink hair! It's a shame that Sports Candy Sprint was never finished, and the Flashpoint version won't let me go beyond the park or pick up any apples, coins, or baseballs. Because isn't the point of the game to take back all the sports candy Robbie stole? Why is Sporticus still happy when you bring back nothing at all? I guess it kinda makes sense considering he's a human golden retriever and will always be proud as long as you try your best, but still. At least the rest of the stuff is still functional, like the skee-ball and basketball games.
Hi, my name is Trey. I have a basketball game tomorrow.
I also admire that one of the clips you can get on the video spaces is the scene where Robbie tries sabotaging Stephanie's dance performance and Sporticus glares him down. He may tolerate most things Robbie does to him, but nobody messes with his adoptive daughter, and I love that reminder. Superhero Challenge and Get Up and Move actually do something interesting. They encourage the kids playing the games to join their selected characters in performing dance moves. I haven't covered a game like that since Silly Hilly Express. Hilariously enough, Robbie Rotten himself joins the fun in Get Up and Move, which is ironic because he's supposed to encourage laziness but also kind of sweet because, according to Stefan Carl Stephenson himself, deep down, Robbie wishes he could be friends with the people of Lazytown. So this is a step in the right direction in spite of his gloating that the kids won't be able to keep up with him. But out of all the Lazytown games, Pixel's Picks takes the cake. Not only is it a whole website canonically made by Pixel himself, the main game was my first exposure to Atari Breakout. And I'll play pretty much any Breakout clone if it controls smoothly, and it does! Not to mention the power-up gimmicks are a nice touch. Tying back into the meme theme of these Nick Jr. shows and their games, in elementary school, everybody I knew would sing, "The phone is ringing," from Wonder Pets, so I'm gonna cover this one next. Strangely enough, the only Wonder Pets game I remember is Save the Sea Creatures, where they go underwater and have to dodge a whale eating its salad every 5 minutes. It was fun. The music is by far the best part of the game. I can vibe the whole way through to the smooth jazz and cartoony nonsense when you save the baby animals, which, by the way, makes for a redundant yet funny intro to the game.
It's a baby blowfish stuck in a sea plant.
And there's a baby seahorse stuck in a sea plant.
And, as if things couldn't get any worse, a baby squid is stuck in a sea plant too.
This is serious.
Look, I'm with you when you say The Backyardigans is one of the best shows Nick Jr. ever made. But their games, kind of underwhelmed me. Remember Mission to Mars? Well, I expected more. No risk, normal speed, a little too simple. It's even too boring to consider relaxing. The Tale of the Mighty Knights is definitely an improvement. This is based on the special episode where Knights Uniqua and Tyrone are tasked by King Pablo to take care of an egg. The horseback and dragon flying portions are sluggish, but the platforming levels rock. High-speed thrills are what I crave, and they delivered perfectly. The background music even matches the mood. The episode itself did a great job in using rock tracks, and they translate into the game seamlessly. The controls can be a little slippery sometimes, especially on the Uniqua platforming level, but that's more of a nitpick. Oh, what about Adventure Maker? That one I liked because although it's just a dress-up game, it's very random. I can have pirates, snow explorers, and royalty in one place if I desire. Overall though, none of these compare to the 3D games, which are on a whole other level but can't be covered because they're not Flash. Sorry, I don't make the rules. Max and Ruby had a few good games. The dress-up game was worth playing solely because of Ruby's wardrobe. She had a lot of pretty dresses, even a princess costume, so it at least has that to make it stand out. And when combined with Give Ken a Hot New Look and Walden's Dress Up, it's one of the only games where you can dress up a boy. Other than that, I loved Max's Toy Bowling, Toy Parade, and Ruby's Soccer Shootout. Max's Toy Bowling puts a spin on bowling games because compared to the Ooh and Ah one I covered earlier, there's a different angle, the pins are toys, and they're all moving across the screen. It's as crazy as it looks. Toy Parade, on the other hand, puts a spin on Snake. Max has to collect his toys to put away, so he has fun and makes a little parade while avoiding the furniture. You're timed as you collect all the toys, but it's easy to get them all. It's actually kind of chill this way, and I can roll with it. Lastly, Ruby's Soccer Shootout has Ruby play soccer against Roger while Luis cheers for her on the sidelines and Max's robots infest the field. It starts easy at first, but then it gets harder to score in the last couple of rounds. You almost become reliant on Max's robots to bump into Roger because that automatically means Ruby scores a point. And you know, that makes seeing how clueless Roger looks when Ruby scores a goal much better later on. It's so dumb and I love it. The best thing about all these games is, in all honesty, the music. I adore the ragtimey pieces, which I believe were ripped straight from the show. Danger, danger. Surprisingly, I barely remember too many Blue's Clues games aside from Doodle Doodle Guess and Draw, which was a Blue's Room game that served as half Pictionary and half freestyle coloring. For a long while, this game convinced me that the Doodle 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 Guess part was impossible to lose. Some of these are actually very hard to guess unless you're really good at shape recognition. I'm rather impressed, since it adds another layer to the fun. The drawing portion is nothing special, but I like the commentary behind it. Blue's voice is super cute.
What you drawing? Ooh, I see.
Also, I gotta say, the Blue's Room games did an amazing job at making Blue's fur look extra fluffy. As for regular Blue's Clues games, where do I even start? The two interactive books were nice. There's Goodnight Bird from Blue's Big Pajama Party, which is just like the interactive books mentioned previously. But what stood out to me was the What's in the Box interactive book, which I don't remember being in any previously established Blue's Clues episodes, but correct me if I'm wrong. The book had Blue, Slippery Soap, Periwinkle, and Tickety Talk imagining what was in the box, and they all sung this weird, trippy, hypnotic song.
As I close my eyes and dream it, then I swirl around and feel it. Then I open my eyes, and I can see it there.
Slippery imagined a boat that could take him sailing across the ocean. Periwinkle imagined an adventure with dragons, trolls, and goblins. Tickety Talk imagined all the numbers she could count, although there was a missed opportunity at allowing both of her hands to make the time be present o'clock. And Blue imagined a bunch of objects she could use to throw a party. But what was really in the box? Get this, it was another box! One that could be anything they imagined it to be. Cue Slippery thinking of a submarine and Blue imagining a rocket. Interestingly, even though we could only hear Blue's bark speak, she was given the same speech bubble as everyone else when she joined their imagination song. Maybe this translation was secretly foreshadowing for Blue's Room, even though Blue's Room wouldn't be a thing until 4 years later, but hey, anything is possible. Yo Gabba Gabba wasn't half bad with their games. These games had Fufo water her flowers, Broby dance when you click on everything on him that glowed, and Muno and Plex playing volleyball together. They're not my favorites, but I still have a few good things to say about them. Fufa's Happy Flower Garden and Muno's Volcano Volleyball are oddly satisfying. Broby looks funny when you click on all his glowing parts, and Magic Word Adventure is by far the best of the bunch. It's a nice little platformer, not quite as fast as Wubsy's Amazing Adventure or Tale of the Mighty Knights, but I like how smooth it runs. You can also choose which character to play as, which is a nice standout compared to the other games being extra specific. Of course, I picked Plex because he's the bot with no realm. But it feels a bit odd that they ripped the level complete music from Dora's Pyramid.
Thank you for your help, Muno!
You're welcome!
The last show I remember watching from Nick Jr. was Ni Hao Kai Lan. Wanna know how old I am? I'm old enough to remember that Kai Lan started out as a series of shorts before becoming a full show, but not young enough to remember any of her games aside from Rintu's Dragon Boat Race. You have to help Rintu and Ho-Ho beat Toli in a boat race, and the faster you wiggle your mouse, the faster they go. This is probably the most cathartic game on the site, even more so than the bumper cars from Dora's Carnival Adventure. I can't help but admire it for that alone. Holly Hobby is by far the strangest appearance on the website. They showed her Christmas movie once on the network, and suddenly she has a whole slew of games on Nick Jr.'s website despite never showing up again. But with that said, I just think they're neat. One of them isn't even a game, it's just a printout paper doll dress-up page, but I like her outfits. They're cute enough to earn a mention. The other two, Beanbag Toss and Muffin Maker, are pretty great. Beanbag Toss is of the tic-tac-toe variety, where three in a row gives you whatever prize it reveals. These range from a pet goldfish and candy to a stuffed animal and a pie from Aunt Jessie. When you finish all your tosses, the game automatically saves your progress before you continue, which means you don't have to try winning everything all over again. However, it took me 5 tries to get the last prize and feel satisfied. As for Muffin Maker, the Hay Girls are making muffins and work on one specific area of the conveyor belt. Holly squirts the frosting, Amy sprinkles toppings, and Carrie pours on fruit. The timing is very important, since if you're not exactly on that sweet spot, you'll end up getting only half of the muffin covered. And unfortunately, the brief second of lag has not been fixed since it stays on nickjr.com, but I'm used to it, so I don't mind it too much. And oh man, the spike in difficulty is noticeable! I felt like Lucy and Ethel when they worked at the chocolate factory. But my favorite part of the game is when you reach the end and get recipes to make muffins in real life. I've never tried baking these types of muffins, but you bet I'm gonna do it someday. Definitely one of my baking goals. Now, trying to find these next two games is near impossible, and I only have true visual proof for only one of them, but I really liked the third-party games. There was this little Tykes driving game that I don't remember all too well. There was also this McDonald's soccer game where you could play as Birdie, Hamburglar, or Grimace and had to be a goalie on the soccer field. I've played as all three, but I was a Birdie main back in the day. Ronald McDonald wasn't playable, but he cheered you on and congratulated you after blocking 5 goals, which was all you needed to do to win the game. Please tell me I'm not the only one who remembers this. Being a kid of the 2000s meant I grew up with Face and Piper. And you know NickJr.com was a great website when even the mascots had great games of their own. Face had alphabet and number games while Piper had the bubble bath guessing game. Faces are more so virtual toys, but I love them regardless. He sings the alphabet to you.
Q-R-S-T-U-V. Wait, I'm not done yet. W-X-Y-N-Z.
Then lets you click on the letters to make something funny or cute happen. I always liked clicking on N for noisy because I used to think it was the peak of comedy.
N is for noisy! I said noisy!
It's still one of my favorite letters, but I recently found more appreciation for the comedic genius of A for art.
Art!
The way the paintbrush slaps Face in the, well, face, and puts a splat on him is so unceremonious and anticlimactic that I can't not find it amusing. I also really like I for invisible because he makes himself fade out of existence for a good few seconds.
I is for invisible.
Thanos, eat your heart out. Face's numbers retains the charm from the alphabet game, but provides more of a choose-your-own-adventure experience since you click on not just a number, but also an object that Face likes. I don't hold as much nostalgia for this one, but it's still nice. Piper's bubble guessing game, on the other hand, is simple and really easy. She uses bubbles to pretend to be other Nick Jr. characters, which reminds me of the Lazy Town is Next bumpers where she wears Sporticus's hat and whisker mustache before trading it in for a Stephanie wig. Despite its simplicity, it makes up for it in length as you have to go through every single character she can pretend to be before she finishes taking her bath. Sometimes Piper gets extra creative with her bubbles, such as using only antenna to be Uniqua. Minimalist, yet effective. She also uses Pablo's cowboy costume because a beak wouldn't translate too well. Oh, and Dora's so special that she gets to be guessed twice, once for her normal style and again as a princess. You know, as far as sparking joy goes, the Oswald games are on a whole different level. Looking back at all the games up to this point made me very happy, but revisiting Oswald flat out reawakened something. I heard that precious blue octopus's sweet, gentle voice for the first time in years thanks to this deep dive, and I just melted.
Hi, I'm Oswald, and this is Big City. There are lots of new things to do here.
The strange thing is that memories of his games were pretty fuzzy before now. I only remembered one specific part of the games, like putting marbles in some jello, a piano with rainbow-colored notes, and the sound of a broken ice cream machine. Playing them all again, though, it all came back to me almost immediately, and I have the most to gush about. The first game doesn't have much to it. You just gotta find Oswald's hat, which could be one of 6 things. However, it's impossible to get it on your first try, so right off the bat, it makes up for the shortness. And even though there's barely much to do compared to other games, the charming animations as well as Oswald himself makes it worth playing at least a couple times. He gets so excited when we find his hat, aww.
Oh boy! You found my hat! Thanks a lot.
And then he calls us his friends, aww!
Anyway, there are lots of new things to do in Big City. Like making new friends such as you.
Speaking of, that's the magic Oswald's games have overall. Compare him to other Nick Jr. characters for a second. Dora, Blue, and Webzy talk regularly to the viewers, so when they talk to us in their games, it's basic routine. But good old Ozzy boy? The only time he addresses the viewers is at the end of his intro, when he does that iconic hat tip. That makes it all the more special when he suddenly talks to us in all his games. It really caught me off guard when I revisited them, and I love it. Moving on to the next game, we have Big Diner Specials. This is definitely the one I played the most. You're at the Big Diner with Oswald, Weenie, Daisy, and Henry, and you gotta help Madame Butterfly prepare the orders. Henry's a man of culture with his seafood pasta combo of trout balls and spaghetti,
Daisy orders sunflower salad. Daisy, you're a flower! What are you doing? And Oswald sharing the mystery lunch with Weenie. What's the mystery in the mystery lunch, you ask?
That's just it.
It's a mystery. After clicking on all the orders, the diner is suddenly really busy, so, of course, Oswald decides to help Madame Butterfly and takes you with him. Looks like we've got front row seats to Ozzie and Maddie sitting in a tree. Once you two arrive at the kitchen, you have to click on the ingredients on the shelves that are on this page of the cookbook. The exception to this rule is the mystery lunch, where Oswald trusts you to make the last ingredient whatever you want. I always pick the little candy jar. This is a simple game just like Find Oswald's Hat, but unlike the previous one, it feels much more like a mini episode we just so happened to play a part in. And in all seriousness, Big Diner Specials is genuinely funny. We've got stuff like Oswald's eye looking like it's gonna fall off the side of his face, the way Madame Butterfly stiffly moves across the screen and doesn't even hover while sitting still, Oswald sounding all playful when you click on something wrong in the cooking portion.
Oh my gosh! That doesn't go in now.
The endearingly derby background music never stops playing after you finish the game. Daisy going into teapot formation when she waves at you. Weenie's as still as a statue and seems to be having a surprisingly intense staring contest with Henry until the end of the game. If you play this game as often as I did in order to uncover every result, you're never gonna unsee the fact that when Oswald looks at his friends, he's suddenly standing, "Excuse me!" Daisy can't even look at you when she greets you. When you put the noodles in the mystery lunch, it says spaghetti in the bottom corner, choosing the boot because the meal will be foot and mouth. Ozzie's adorable head-scratching animation. I'll have the sunflower salad with jingleberry dressing, please, being ingrained in your head after running through the game at least 3 times, not to mention I'd love to see it on a shirt. Oswald's still sounding genuine when he says the mystery lunch with a boot in it looks yummy.
That looks yummy.
Thinking the candy jar is filled with gumballs only to realize they're actually marbles. Putting sunglasses in Oswald's lunch because come on, that's inherently cool. The ingredient you picked for the mystery lunch will stay in that corner of the screen should you play again until you go back to the kitchen. Weenie's barks clearly not being Debbie Dairyberries. Daisy's salad looking nothing like a salad and more like a bowl of oatmeal with strange blue sauce. The fact that they reuse the exact same "that's right" voice clip whenever you and Ozzie make the food.
That's right, that's right, that's right, that's right, that's right, that's right, that's right. That's right.
And finally, the ending jingle sounding like that one Bounty commercial Nick Jr. used to play 3 years after this game was released.
The Quilted Quickmaker Upper Bounty.
I don't know, maybe I'm just too easily amused, but I'm having fun here, and that's what really counts, right? I also find this game relaxing. I could play it for an hour straight, and I'm awarding bonus points here because of lore. Yeah. That's right, a game based on a preschool show that's not directly recreating one of the episodes, or a portion of it in Wubsy's Amazing Adventures case, makes great use of callbacks from earlier episodes. The mystery lunch is ordered by Oswald and I Guess You Never Know, with the mystery there being little rocket-shaped sprinkles.
Oswald, what's the mystery in the Monday mystery lunch?
That's just it. It's a mystery.
What's the mystery in the mystery lunch, Oswald?
That's just it. It's a mystery.
Henry serves trout balls and spaghetti when Oswald and Weenie go to his place in the sleepover. The sunglasses are also from that episode, since Ozzie needs them to sleep in a bright room and later gives them to Steve the tree and Down in the Dump. And the boot is worn by Henry as a hat to cover the feather sticking out of his head in Henry Needs a Haircut. Oh yeah, it's all coming together. The next game is just as fun as Big Diner Specials, although it lacks the amount of replay value Big Diner Specials has. In Oswald's Piano, Oswald is gonna play the Penguin Polka for Weenie, but he needs our help to master such a classic banger. You gotta press the rainbow keys that match the notes, then Oswald plays the whole song for you and Weenie to jam out to. Not gonna lie, I think the piano cover is even better than the original. Also, look at how fluid his tentacles move! Incredible! Anyway, when the piece is finished, you can play more songs. Click play again, and Oswald gets really excited.
Would you like to play another song?
Oh, there goes my heart, it's melting into a little puddle, aww. So if you play again, you can teach Oswald how to play Mary Had a Little Lamb and Pop Goes the Weasel, and both of these are pretty solid renditions. They've got a jazzy flair to them. I'm also pretty sure that Mary Had a Little Lamb has the same BPM as Lottery by K-Camp, so do whatever you want with that info.
Oswald's piano is worth playing just for these rendition, as well as listening to Ozzy compliment you.
That was swell. Thanks for showing me how to play that part. Now I think I can play the whole song.
Sure. You play a tiny snippet of a song with only one hand, while he flawlessly plays the whole thing with two tenties and no fingers. But hey, it's the thought that counts. And just like the game before it, it's packed with lore. Although, not as much. At the end of the sleepover, Oswald is given sheet music for the Penguin Polka and learns to play it on the piano for Weenie when they're back home. And in Odd One Out, he plays it for Henry when his cousin Louie comes to town and their record player breaks. So now we have this game, where Oswald asks us to help him play the song, and it's safe to assume it happens sometime between these two episodes. You know what that means? We really are part of the show! And more importantly, the games are canon! Canonically, we're the reason Oswald even knows how to play the song!
With that knowledge, I'll gladly play my part. Henry's Puzzle is the next game, and this time you're playing with only Henry. This is really nice. He may be a picky little lad, but he's more than happy to let you play with his jigsaw because he loves it when people like the things he likes. All you gotta do is click on a piece, then click on where it should go. The stuff he says when he encourages you is also adorkable, especially, that's using your noodle. And don't get me started on the pictures. They're so pure! Look at all these guys having a good time. I just want them to be happy. Although, when I play this game, I find it a shame in retrospect that Daisy didn't get a game of her own the same way Henry did. It would have been super cool. But at the same time, it probably would have ended up more in line with Wubsy's Amazing Adventure, which is the type of game the Oswald section is trying to avoid. Nonetheless, I'm glad Henry got some time to shine. The final game in the Oswald lineup is Oswald's Ice Cone Game. Weird title, I know, but I didn't pick it. This is probably the one people remember the most, aside from Big Diner Specials. Basically, the snow cone machine goes haywire, and Oswald has to give Weenie, Henry, and Daisy their ice cream while the machine spits out the flavors like cannonballs. Weenie wants Swizzleberry Swirl, Henry fancies Salmon Sorbet, and Daisy prefers a Sunflower Sundae, so we're stylishly serving up scoops and smiles. Splendid! Stupendous, if I say so myself. As each ball of ice cream falls down the screen, Oswald needs to catch the right flavor for each person. It's also the closest you'll ever get to high-speed thrills, especially if you play on harder mode. Oh yeah, this game has an easy mode and a hard mode. Easy mode is a good test of patience, but I prefer hard mode since it gives you more things to do. And by that I mean there's more ice cream balls to toss into the abyss while waiting for the right flavor to drop down, not to mention they fall faster overall. This is great because you don't get penalized in any way. There's no point system, and Ozzy literally doesn't bat an eye as he throws the other flavors off screen. He just keeps smiling and staring at you without saying a single word. It makes an already fun game even better! There's less dialogue here, as well as that disembodied female voice from every Nick Jr. commercial joining the fun.
Can you help Oswald make treats for all his friends? Click on a friend so you can hear their order.
But like Big Diner Specials, we do get an iconic line, this time from Henry.
I'd like a salmon sorbet, please.
A+ delivery. But that's probably unfair given that Oswald's Ice Cone Game is loosely based on the series finale Snow to Go and ripped that line, as well as more than half of the dialogue straight from that episode.
I'd like a salmon sorbet, please.
Sunflower sundae, please.
Swizzleberry swirl terrini, please.
Additionally, like Big Diner Specials and Oswald's Piano, this game contains, you guessed it, lore. The flavors Weenie and Henry want are shown in Chasing the Ice Cream Truck. But interestingly, they look drastically different here. Whereas the episode version of Swizzleberry Swirl is shown as a pastel pink soft serve with raspberry-like fruits on it, the game version is changed into more of a magenta color with added purple streaks and turned into ball form since it makes more sense in terms of game design. It may also be justified since this is for Weenie instead of Oswald, so the drastic change could indicate that the game's version is a pet-friendly substitute. Salmon Sorbet, on the other hand, is closer to its on-screen counterpart. It's a fish-shaped popsicle in the episode, and while the game changes it into ball form, the primary color remains the same with an added scaly pattern to convey more detail. Daisy's flavor isn't introduced until Snow to Go, but the Sunflower Sundae looks no different than a Hot Fudge Sundae with a pretty flower sprinkle pattern. In Oswald's Ice Cone Game, it's blue like cotton candy and has more detailed flower patterns. It looks the least like ice cream and bears a closer resemblance to a bouncy ball, but it fits considering Daisy's love for many things sports related. Also, can we appreciate the way Oswald moves here? Look at those tenties! He moves them like a Bop It game! Yeah, without a doubt, this is definitely top 3 material. I keep switching between this one, Big Diner Specials, and Oswald's Piano as my favorite Oswald game. Regardless of which one I finally pick, if I ever do, there's no denying that Oswald's Ice Cone game is perfect for certified hardcore gamers. Too bad Ozzy didn't get his own ice cream in the end, though. But I guess it doesn't matter, because his friends are happy, and that makes him happy, so I'm happy too. Nick Jr. has done crossover games before, but I'm surprised they didn't capitalize that concept on a larger scale. Tic-Tac-Toe didn't have the characters interact, but when you picked your profile avatar, you could choose from Dora, Blue, Uniqua, Diego, Sportacus, and Little Bill, who I've avoided like the plague until now, because as far as those allegations are concerned, Bill Cosby is trash. It's a standard Tic-Tac-Toe game, but where it shines the most is the music. It can go pretty hard when it wants to. The bingo one slightly improves the crossover aspect since the characters interact with the player, but this time you have even less to pick from. Dora and Diego of course return, but the only other characters you can pick from are Pablo and Ming Ming. It's a surprisingly good bingo game since you can choose from 3 difficulty options and 3 board options, but the music department has less bangers to offer. Thankfully, it continues to make up for it by having a store to win prizes similar to Dora's Carnival Adventure, even down to getting tickets for every bingo game you win. But let's be honest here, there's one other crossover game that takes the cake for how iconic it is, beating out these other two by a long shot despite retaining the lack of actual character interaction. That game, dear viewers, is none other than Take Care of Baby. It's more akin to a virtual toy since it's sorted under the Click Junior category, but I still love it to death. In this game, you have 4 babies you can take care of. Dora, Blue, Oswald, and Little Bill. When you're looking after a baby, you've got 4 items. A blanket, a bottle, a music box, and a toy. You gotta click on them to give to your baby when they make a specific gesture. Some of these items work for more than one cue, as the music box can be used when the baby is sleeping, crying, or bored. And when the baby cries, any of the items will work. This game aged like fine wine because look at the babies! They're so cute! Since Dora was my favorite as a kid, that made her my main baby. I still think she's adorable as a baby, but nowadays my heart particularly goes out to Blue and Oswald. Blue snuggling up with her teddy bear and her sleeping animation while she dreams about going to the moon is really, really cute. She also looks surprisingly similar to her puppy form from that one Christmas special, albeit with longer ears and no diaper. And Oswald is obviously the cutest baby. Look at his itty-bitty baseball cap and tendies! If I could, I would play with baby Ozzy all day long. Also, I love how the comically tiny hat proves that Oswald's hat being way too small for his head is an unspoken necessity. Little Bill's fun to play with too, regardless of my opinion on Cosby. Can I also say that the music boxes are awesome? I wished I had Dora's Carousel as a kid, but I had a good substitute since I'm pretty sure the tune is the same lullaby my grandma would sing to me. And just a tiny bit of lore is present here because the piano music box for Oswald plays his theme. I knew I could count on Oswald to deliver that sweet big-brained lore even when he's an itty-bitty baby that can fit in the palms of my hands. Seriously, I could play this for hours, if not days. Talk about a sweet and perfectly wholesome note to end on.
What a good helper you've been.
Thank you.
Looking back at these nostalgic Flash games, I'm so happy at how well they hold up. And considering most of these are licensed games, you'd think they were doomed to age poorly. But you can tell that for the most part, they had a lot of effort and care put into them. Which I really appreciate, since as stated in the beginning, Flash games were typically our first exposure to the video game world, and thus they were in charge of preparing us to play with the big boys like Super Mario and Sonic the Hedgehog. This may be the end of an era, but I'll never forget the impact Adobe Flash had on all our childhoods. And seeing other games being made in a similar vein gives me hope. Flash Player's game is over, but its legacy shall remain strong. Anyway, that's all for today. Like, comment, subscribe, and what were your favorite childhood Flash games? Please let me know. But for now, this is MK, signing off.